Hey, Linux enthusiasts, welcome back to Tun Does Linux, and wow, what an absolutely massive week we've had in the Linux world. I'm talking Linux kernel 6.16 officially dropping, major distribution shakeups, some seriously concerning security news, and desktop environment updates that are going to change how you use Linux. If you're new here, I'm Tun, and this channel is all about diving deep into Linux like never before. Whether you're a complete beginner or a seasoned pro, we break down the complex stuff and make it actually useful for your daily Linux experience. So grab your favorite beverage, hit that subscribe button if you haven't already, and let's dive into this week's Linux news that you absolutely need to know about. All right, let's start with the big news. Linux kernel 6.16 is officially here. Linus Torvalds released it yesterday, July 27th. And folks, this is not just another incremental update. This kernel is absolutely packed with improvements that are going to make your Linux experience significantly better. First up, performance improvements across the board. We're talking about optimizations that affect everything from boot times to application responsiveness. The kernel now includes the x86 native CPU build option, which means you can optimize your kernel specifically for your CPU architecture using the NADE-MARCH native compiler flag. This is huge for performance enthusiasts who want to squeeze every bit of speed out of their systems. But here's where it gets really exciting. NVIDIA users, this one's for you. Linux 6.16 brings open source support for NVIDIA's latest Hopper and Blackwell GPU architectures through the Nuvo driver. Yes, you heard that right. We're finally getting proper open source support for NVIDIA's cutting-edge hardware. This means better compatibility, more stable drivers, and most importantly, you're not locked into NVIDIA's proprietary driver ecosystem. Intel users aren't left out either. The kernel now includes preparations for Intel's Advanced Performance Extensions, or APX. This is Intel's next-generation instruction set that's going to significantly boost performance for compatible processors. While we're still waiting for the hardware to hit the market, having kernel support ready means we'll be able to take advantage of these features from day one. Let's talk about some of the other technical improvements that might not make headlines, but will definitely improve your daily experience. We've got XFS Atomic Write support, which means better data integrity for those using XFS file systems. There's a very nice ext4 performance improvement that's going to make file operations faster. The kernel also includes initial USB audio offloading support, which is particularly exciting for Qualcomm hardware users. And here's something that's going to make VPN users very happy. The OpenVPN DCO kernel driver has finally been upstreamed. DCO stands for Data Channel Offload, and this is going to significantly improve OpenVPN performance by handling data processing directly in the kernel space instead of bouncing between user space and kernel space. Just to put this in perspective, the Linux 6.16 source tree weighs in at 38.4 million lines of code across 78,400 files. That's an absolutely massive code base, and the fact that it all works together seamlessly is a testament to the incredible work of the Linux kernel development community. Looking ahead, the Linux 6.17 merge window is already underway, and it's shaping up to be another exciting release. This kernel is particularly important because it's expected to power Ubuntu 25.10 and should be the default kernel for Fedora 43 and other late 2025 distribution releases. Now, let's talk distributions, and we've got some really interesting updates this week. First up is KOS 2025.07, and this release is making some bold moves. KOS has officially gone Qt5 free, which means they're fully committed to the Qt6 ecosystem. This is a significant decision that shows their dedication to staying on the cutting edge of desktop technology. KOS 2025.07 ships with KDE Plasma 6.4.3, and they've completely refreshed their Midna theme. The new theme looks absolutely gorgeous, with updated visuals that really showcase what modern Linux desktops can look like. They've also made their SDDM display manager Wayland ready, which is crucial as we continue the transition away from X11. One of the cool additions is a new virtual keyboard implementation, which is going to be particularly useful for tablet users and touch-enabled devices. They've also included Amarok, the classic KDE music player, which is great news for users who prefer a more traditional music management experience. On the privacy front, Tails 6.18 has been released with some important security enhancements. The big addition here is WebTunnel Bridges support, which provides an additional layer of anonymity for users in restrictive network environments. They've also updated the Tor browser to the latest version, ensuring users have the most recent security patches and privacy features. Speaking of major releases, Debian 13 is set to launch on August 9th, and it's going to ship with KDE Plasma 6.3.6. What's interesting here is that Plasma 6.3.6 landed in Debian just one day before the full freeze, which shows how committed the Debian team is to providing users with the most recent stable desktop environment. Now here's some news that might surprise you. Intel has officially discontinued Clear Linux OS. This is actually a pretty big deal, because Clear Linux was known for its exceptional performance optimizations and was often used as a benchmark for what Linux could achieve on Intel hardware. Intel is pulling the plug on this project, which means users will need to migrate to other distributions. This discontinuation highlights an important point about the Linux ecosystem. While we have incredible diversity in distributions, it also means that projects can come and go. If you are using Clear Linux, don't panic. Distributions like Fedora, OpenSUSE, Tumbleweed, or even Arch Linux can provide similar performance characteristics with the right configuration. Speaking of performance distributions, CacheOS is gaining significant traction in 2025. This distribution is specifically optimized for gaming and high-performance computing, and according to recent ProtonDB statistics, it's becoming increasingly popular among Linux gamers. CacheOS uses aggressive compiler optimizations and includes performance-focused kernel patches that can significantly improve gaming performance. Linux Mint users have something to look forward to as well. Linux Mint 22.2 beta is expected soon. The development team is shifting focus to this new release, which should bring updated packages and improved hardware support, while maintaining Mint's reputation for stability and user-friendliness. Let's dive into desktop environment updates, starting with KDE Plasma 6.4.3. This release focuses primarily on bug fixes and stability improvements, which might not sound exciting, but trust me, these are the updates that make your daily Linux experience smoother and more reliable. However, it's worth noting that some Fedora 42 users are reporting crashes with Plasma 6.4.3, particularly issues with Plasma Shell breaking after waking from sleep on systems with NVIDIA GPUs. If you're running Fedora with NVIDIA hardware, you might want to hold off on this update until these issues are resolved. On the GNOME side, GWATOC 2025 is currently happening, and there's some exciting development news coming out of the conference. One of the most interesting projects being showcased is GNOME Foundry, which is taking shape as an IDE in a box. With comprehensive CLI tooling, this could be a game changer for developers who want a fully integrated development environment that's built specifically for the GNOME ecosystem. Looking at the GNOME development timeline, GNOME 49 is approaching its API freeze on August 2nd, 2025. This means we're getting close to seeing what new features and improvements will be included in the next major GNOME release. Now let's talk about application updates, because we've had some significant releases this week. Shotcut 25.07 has been released with a speech-to-text model, which is going to be incredibly useful for video editors who need to generate subtitles or transcripts automatically. Firefox 141 is now available for download, bringing the latest security patches and performance improvements. Mozilla continues to be one of the most important open source projects, and staying current with Firefox updates is crucial for both security and compatibility. Thunderbird 141 has also been released with some nice usability improvements, including an archive button and OpenPGP expiry warnings. These might seem like small features, but they significantly improve the email management experience for users who rely on Thunderbird for their daily communication. For audio enthusiasts, we've got two Pipewire updates this week. Pipewire 1.4.7 brings echo cancellation improvements and latency fixes, while Pipewire 1.2.8 focuses on better ALSA and pulse audio handling. Pipewire has become the de facto standard for Linux audio, and these updates continue to improve compatibility and performance across different audio setups. System administrators will appreciate the release of IPFire 2.29 Core Update 196, which includes a WireGuard performance boost. WireGuard has become increasingly popular for VPN setups, and any performance improvements are welcome news for network administrators. FWUPD 2.0.13 has been released with faster startup times and lower memory usage. FWUPD is crucial for keeping your hardware firmware up to date, and these performance improvements mean less system overhead when checking for and installing firmware updates. Raspberry Pi users will be happy to know that Raspberry Pi Imager 1.9.6 brings better SSH validation, making it easier and more secure to set up headless Raspberry Pi installations. Let's talk hardware support, because this week has brought some significant improvements that are going to benefit a wide range of users. The upcoming Linux 6.17 kernel is already showing promising developments in power management, with refined async suspend and resume functionality that's going to improve battery life and system responsiveness on laptops. Intel users have a lot to be excited about. Linux 6.17 is adding support for more Intel hardware, including improvements for upcoming processor architectures. The kernel is also getting Intel Energy Aware Scheduling for their key state driver, which will provide better energy efficiency on Lunar Lake and the upcoming Panther Lake SoCs. ARM users aren't being left behind either. Linux 6.17 will support ARM's BRBE, that's Branch Record Buffer Extension, which provides enhanced debugging and profiling capabilities for ARM 64 processors. This is particularly important as ARM processors become more prevalent in both server and desktop environments. Now here's some concerning news for NVIDIA users. More GPU driver security issues have been revealed for July 2025. While the specific details haven't been fully disclosed yet, this highlights the ongoing security challenges with proprietary GPU drivers. This is yet another reason why the open source Nuvo improvements in Linux 6.16 are so important. AMD users are getting some nice improvements as well. The Linux 6.16 kernel includes AMD SBI support for their sideband interface and advanced platform management link. There's also AMD allowed SEV feature support for KVM, which enhances virtualization capabilities on AMD processors. One of the most exciting developments is the continued improvement in Qualcomm's Snapdragon X laptop support. Linux 6.16 enables support for more Qualcomm Snapdragon X laptops on the mainline kernel, which means better out-of-the-box compatibility for these ARM-based Windows laptops when running Linux. The initial USB audio offloading support for Qualcomm hardware is also noteworthy. This feature has been in development for a long time, and having it finally land in the mainline kernel means better audio performance and lower CPU usage for Qualcomm-based devices. RISC-V enthusiasts have something to celebrate as well. The AMD KFT compute driver for ROCm can now be enabled on RISC-V hardware, which opens up new possibilities for high-performance computing on this open-source processor architecture. There's also some interesting news for users of older hardware. Linux 6.16 even includes a fix for the old Macintosh 2, which shows the incredible commitment of the Linux community to supporting hardware across decades of computer history. Laptop users will benefit from numerous Linux laptop driver improvements, including the new Desharo ACPI driver for those using Core Boot-based firmware. There's also support for the BioWave Modular Proteus Controller Kit, which was contributed by a Valve engineer, showing Valve's continued commitment to improving Linux gaming hardware support. Let's talk about some major community developments that are going to shape the future of Linux and open source. The biggest news is that the Open Infrastructure Foundation, which manages OpenStack, has officially joined the Linux Foundation as of July 23, 2025. This is huge for cloud computing and infrastructure management, as it brings one of the most important cloud platforms under the Linux Foundation umbrella. Google has announced the OSS Rebuild Project, which is designed to strengthen trust in open source package ecosystems by reproducing upstream artifacts. This is a direct response to recent supply chain security concerns in the open source world, and it's going to help ensure that the packages you install are actually what the developers intended to release. Speaking of security, we need to talk about some concerning developments. The Chaos Rat malware has been discovered in open source repositories, which emphasizes the critical importance of verifying the software you install. This discovery reinforces the trust but verify principle that should guide all open source software usage. Arch Linux users need to be particularly careful, as malware has been discovered in AUR packages. The AUR's community-maintained nature makes it particularly vulnerable to these types of attacks, so always verify package sources and maintainers before installing anything from the AUR. On a more positive note, Linux gaming continues to grow. The Humble Choice July 2025 bundle includes games that perform excellently on Steam Deck, and there's increasing discussion about upcoming gaming-focused distributions. Catchy OS, in particular, is being highlighted for its gaming performance optimizations. There's also growing evidence that MMO gaming on Linux is becoming more viable. More players are successfully running their favorite MMORPGs on Linux systems, which is great news for gamers who want to make the complete switch to Linux without sacrificing their gaming experience. The broader open source development community is thriving as well. We're seeing new projects launching regularly, including open source CRM alternatives and infrastructure tools that compete with commercial offerings like Heroku and Render. The innovation happening in the open source space is absolutely incredible. Community events are also keeping the Linux ecosystem vibrant. The CentOS Showcase 2025-07 recently highlighted the work happening in the CentOS ecosystem. And OpenSearchCon North America is coming up in September with a registration deadline of July 31st. Wow, what an absolutely packed week in the Linux world. We've covered the massive Linux kernel 16.16 release with its performance improvements and NVIDIA Blackwell support. Major distribution updates including KOS going Kube5 free and the upcoming Debian 13 release. Desktop environment improvements, significant hardware support enhancements, and important community developments. The security news this week serves as an important reminder. Always verify your software sources, keep your systems updated, and stay informed about potential threats. The Linux community's strength lies in its transparency and collaborative approach to security. If this video helped you stay up to date with the Linux world, smash that like button and subscribe for more weekly Linux news and tutorials. Hit the notification bell so you never miss an update. And let me know in the comments which of these developments you're most excited about. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next video where we'll continue diving into the world of Linux like never before. Until then, keep exploring, keep learning, and keep doing Linux.